Thank you. So I'm happy to continue this the topic of Rishabha, which we on which we had a few papers now already. Being the first Tirthankara, biographies of Rishabha or Adinatha are particularly numerous. Naturally, one finds versions in the complete so-called universal histories, compositions termed Puranas or Charitras, which narrate the lives of the 63 Shalaka Purushas, i.e. the 24 Tirthankaras, 12 Chakravartins, and 9 triads of Baladevas, Vasudevas, and Prativasudevas. There is, for instance, the Mahapurana of Jinasena and Gunabhadra, and the Apabhramsha Mahapuranu of Pushpadanta from the 10th century, or the Chaupana Mahapurisacharya of Sri Lanka, also from the 10th century, but of course the most famous example is undoubtedly Himachandra's Trishashti Shalaka Purusha Charitra from the 12th century. But Rishabha's biography is also found in Puranic compositions where one would less expect them, such as the Jain Ramayanas and the Harivamsa Mahabharatas. Most of these Jain Puranas strive to emulate the orthodox Puranic model, offering a parallel to its Panchalakshana model of 5 requisite subjects, so Sarga and Pratisarga, the creation and recreation of the world, Manvantara, the intervals of the Manus, Vamsha, the dynasties of the gods, and Vamsha Anucharita, the legendary royal lineages, especially of the solar and the lunar races. This explains why so many Jain Puranic texts do not immediately commence the story after which they are named, but with a description of the universe and the different time periods, so the Ut and Avasarpinis. This parallels the Lakshanas of Sarga and Pratisarga. We are now in a degenerative period of time, an Avasarpini, having started out in the best possible situation, a Bhoga Bhumi, when people did not need to make any effort for their upkeep, so everything was growing on wishing trees, on the Kalpavrikshas, there was no fear, no disease, etc. Gradually, things are getting more unpleasant, and eventually the wishing trees disappeared. At a certain point during this Avasarpini, people became victims to evil, and there arose a need for the institution of law and punishment. Parallel to this, 14 kulakaras in the Digambara sources, 7 in Shvetambara sources, which are basically parallels to the orthodox Manus, were born in succession to educate the people on the changes going on around them. The last of these kulakaras, or patriarchs, was the father of Rishabha, Nabhiraja. This links the theme of Manvantara very nicely indeed with the biography of the first Tirthankara. Moreover, according to the Jains, Rishabha is a progenitor of the solar dynasty, the Ikshvaku Vamsha, connecting him to the orthodox subject of Vamshanucharita. So according to some texts, his lineage was named Ikshvaku because he drank Ikshu, sugarcane, from Indra when he was, which he received from Indra when he was just 1 year old. And according to other texts, this has to do with the fact that Rishabha taught the people to squeeze sugarcane for its juice. So as one of the many things he taught to the people during his life as a king. Here, Rishabha is portrayed as more than just a Tirthankara, continuing the work of his father, the Kulakara. The same can be said of Rishabha installing the Varnas, except, of course, for the Brahmana Varna, teaching the people the professions, so this Asi, Mashi, Krishi, etc. It is safe to say that in the Jain Puranas, Rishabha is more than a Tirthankara who receives and teaches the eternal Dharma. As a progenitor of the Ikshvaku Vamsha, it makes sense that his biography is told in the Jain Ramayanas, since Rama is here considered one of his direct descendants. He is moreover also linked to the ruler, to the lunar or Soma or Hari Vamsha, which was started by one Soma Prabha or Soma or Shashi, the grandson of Rishabha and son of Bahubali. So this again explains why his story is told in the Jain stories of Krishna, the Harivamsa Puranas, or Mahabharatas, or Pandavacharitas. So in effect, the corpus of Rishabha biographies is very vast and goes back to the earliest examples of Jain Puranic literature, such as Vimalasuri's Paumacharyam, which at the latest dates from the 5th century, and Sangadasa's Vasudeva Hindi, also at the latest around the same time. But also it is found also in Jinasena Punata's Harivamsa Purana from the 7th century, etc. Predating these texts, we also find his life sketched briefly in Shvetambara, in the Shvetambara Agamas, for instance, in the Kalpa Sutra. His life is basically as follows, and now I'm repeating, I'm basically summarizing what we learned yesterday. So my summary is after the oldest three Jain Ramayanas, but it is more or less generic for the older biographies, differing only in the order of the events. So at some point during this Avasarpini, the Kulakaras, so either 7 or 14, were born successively to instruct the people. The last one, King Nabi, was married to the beautiful Marudevi. They were destined to be the parents of the Tirthankara. After all sorts of divine occurrences, so you have the goddesses coming to service the queen, the experience of either 14 or 16 dreams, rains of gemstones and gold coming from the gods, etc., the boy is born. When the gods become aware of his birth, Dhanada, or Kubera, the god Kubera, is instructed by Indra to build the city of Ayodhya, also called Saketa or Vinita, for them. And here, there is some slight difference with the Shvetambara versions, where the city of Vinita is generally built later, but also by divine intervention at the occasion of Rishabha's coronation. The child is then taken away by Indra and the other gods to be consecrated on Mount Meru, as is usual for a jinnah. He is then returned to his parents and named Rishabha. The reasons given for the name giving differ in the different sources. So some say it's because of the vision of the bull as the first dream of Marudevi. Others say it's because he is the leader, and then Rishabha in the secondary meaning as leader is given, you know, as the reason for the name. As he grows up, the last wishing trees disappear and people come to King Nabi for help. He directs them to Rishabha for instruction. And Rishabha marries and begets many sons, 100 according to most sources, and he becomes the king. And here again, there is sometimes a difference in the order of events. So sometimes he marries first and then becomes a king. Then one day he sees an apsaras, the apsaras Nilanjana, who dies right in front of him, and then he becomes disgusted with the material world and renounces it. In a divine palanquin, he is taken to a park, which is variously named, but mostly referred to Siddhartha or Siddhartaka. Another name sometimes associated with this park is Prayaga. So this is the idea of the origin of Prayag being a Jain place, the place where Rishabha renounced the world. And together with many other kings, he becomes an ascetic. Thereafter, he starts to roam the earth until he reaches a place, Hastinapura or Gajapura, where he breaks his fast with Shreyamsa by drinking sugarcane juice. Rishabha then proceeds to Purimatala and enters the park Shakatamukha, where after a long period of meditation, he attains Kevala Jnana. The gods arrive and a Samavasarana is constructed for Rishabha to hold his first sermon. One of these people attending is a king called Rishabhasena or Vrishabhasena, who becomes the first of 84 Ganadharas. After the preaching, the gods depart and the jinnah leaves the park to roam around with his following. Usually, the Jain Puranas here now commence the story of Bharata and Bahubali and their struggle and their battle. And then after this and the death of Bahubali, Rishabha proceeds to Mount Kailasa or Ashtapada, where he reaches the ultimate liberation, so where he dies, basically. The text may differ in certain details or in the order of events, but most of the story is the same. So Rishabha is the son of the Kulakara, Nabi, and Marudevi. His city is Ayodhya, or Saketa, or Vinita, and he renounced the world after seeing Apsaras die in a park called Siddhartha. He breaks his fast with Shreyamsa in Hastinapura, attains Kevalajnana in Purimatala, roams around with a following, including 84, again we have the number 84, which is interesting, 84 Ganadharas, first of whom is Rishabhasena. And in the end, he dies on Mount Kailasa. In the older stories, there is basically no great distinction along the Digambara-Shvetambara lines, except for the number of dreams of the mother, 16 or 14, and the number of Kulakaras, and then the order of events. Now, interestingly, significant changes occur in Rishabha's biographies from around the 10th, 11th century. In the Shvetambara accounts, passages are inserted describing Rishabha's visits and sermons on Shatrunjaya, the greatest of all Shvetambara pilgrimage sites. They further describe how his chief Ganadhara, called Pundarika here in most texts, attains liberation on Shatrunjaya. For this reason, Mount Shatrunjaya is also sometimes called Mount Pundarika. Strikingly, none of the earlier biographies of Rishabha mention a Pundarika as a Ganadhara to Rishabha, but instead agree on the name Rishabhasena or Rishabhasena as the name of Rishabha's first Ganadhara. The Gambaras continue to use this name after the 11th century, whereas Shvetambaras from then on either name the Ganadhara Pundarika or alternate Pundarika with Rishabhasena, Vrishabhasena. Now, the best known description of Shatrunjaya associated with Rishabha is probably that of the Vividha Tirthakalpa of Jinaprabhasuri from the 14th century, a famous guidebook to Shvetambara pilgrimage sites. But an earlier account is also found in the Saravali, one of the canonical Painaya Prakirnaka texts, so the mixed texts, perhaps also dating from the 11th century. The earliest Puranic account linking Rishabha with Shatrunjaya appears to be from the biography of Rishabha in Himachandra's famous narrative of the lives of the 63 great men of Jainism composed in the 12th century, so probably soon after the composition of the Saravali. In the sixth chapter of the first Parvan, after Rishabha attains enlightenment in a park near Ayodhya, he travels to Mount Ashtapada, where a sacred preaching hall, a Samavasarana, is constructed by the gods for him. His son Bharata, who has just become a Chakravartin, visits him on this occasion and hears his sermons. Rishabha then goes to roam the world, returns again to Mount Ashtapada for sermons, after which Himachandra describes how he, and then I quote from the translation of Johnson, surrounded by Pundarika and other Ganadharas, went purifying the earth under pretext of wandering. Mentioning the places he purified with his presence until he reached Shatrunjaya in the land of the Saurashtras. Here, the story shortly abandons the rather legendary geography for a more realistic, albeit idealistic, version. Himachandra describes Mount Shatrunjaya in 20 verses, conform with standard poetic conventions rather than reality. The mountain is described as being 50 yojanas in circumference at its base, 10 at its peak, and 8 yojanas high. And so if you, basically the same height as Mount Ashtapada, which is also 8 yojanas high. Rishabha ascends the mountain and enters the Samavasarana constructed there by the gods. After a 3-hour sermon, Pundarika, named as Rishabha's supreme Ganadhara, seats himself on Rishabha's footstool and himself gives a sermon on the Jain Dharma. After some days of presence on Shatrunjaya, Rishabha left to wander elsewhere, instructing Pundarika to stay on Shatrunjaya. And here I quote again, "You remain here on the mountain, surrounded by crores of munis. Here your omniscience and that of the followers will appear soon from the power of the place." This quote-unquote power of the place is again stressed in the words of Pundarika when he instructs his crores of followers to engage in Salekhana, a fast until death. In due course, all attain omniscience and liberation, and the gods come from heaven to celebrate this. Hemachandra concludes, just as the master, the blessed Rishabha, was the first Tirthakrit, or Tirthankara, so Mount Shatrunjaya became the first Tirtha. And then he describes how Bharata made a shrine on Shatrunjaya, where he installed a statue of Rishabha and Pundarika. Aside from Hemachandra's great epic, the Saravali and the Vivida Tirtha Kalpa and other guidebooks to Shvetambara pilgrimage places, this account is also found narrated in the Shatrunjaya Mahatmya by Dhaneshwara Suri. Now, despite having been dated to the 5th or 7th century by early scholars such as Weber, internal evidence seems to suggest a date no earlier than the 14th century. This certainly parallels the development of the Rishabha story in the corpus of Jain Puranic and narrative literature. Several scholars estimated that Shatrunjaya may have attained some status as a sacred Jain place from around the 5th century onwards, because it is mentioned on several occasions in the Shvetambara Agamas, though none of these appear to be in connection with Rishabha. Yet even though the site is not referred to in the early Puranas in connection with Rishabha, Shatrunjaya is not absent in these early Jain Puranas and other narrative literature. Pre-11th century Puranic poets, both Digambara and Shvetambara, such as Gunabhadra, Jinasena Punata, and Shilanka, name it as a site where the Pandavas, from the Jain version of the Mahabharata, attain spiritual liberation. Final liberation, sorry. Because these characters are not really considered great men or Shalaka Purushas, the poets do not really spend a lot of words on the description of this site or of the event. After the Shvetambaras began to associate Mount Shatrunjaya with Rishabha, for Digambaras it simply remained the site where the Pandavas attained liberation, and as such for them it was still a Siddha Kshetra and worthy of respect. What is further interesting to note is that some later Shvetambara authors appear to attempt to loosen this Shatrunjaya-Pandava association. So for instance, in Hemachandra's account of the emancipation of the Pandavas, he refers to the mountain named Vimala. So what we see is that authors seem to want to avoid the name of Shatrunjaya itself when it comes to the liberation site of the Pandavas. Likewise, we have Devendra Gani in his Tika on the Uttaradhyayana Sutra dating from the 13th century. He refrains from using the name Shatrunjaya, instead using the name Pundarika for the lotus of the liberation of the Pandavas. Nevertheless, Vimala and Pundarika are known as other names of Mount Shatrunjaya, though neither Hemachandra nor Devendra Gani are explicit about this. Maladhari Deva Prabhasuri, in his Pandava Charita, also names the site of liberation of the Pandavas Mount Vimala, but he does refer to the munis such as Pundarika attaining emancipation at this, and which he, quote-unquote, the greatest of all tirthas. These additions and changes to the Shvetambara accounts of the Rishabha story, namely, one, the inclusion of Shatrunjaya as a place he visited, and two, Rishabha's Ganadhara, named Pundarika, reaching final liberation there, run parallel to the history of the rise to significance of Mount Shatrunjaya as a sacred site. Despite references to a sacred site, Shatrunjaya, before the 10th century, the oldest surviving inscription on the site dates from the year 1006 and is found on an icon representing Pundarika, located near the main Adishwara temple. Digambara accounts stay the same throughout history, both regarding Rishabha's Ganadhara and the sacredness of Mount Shatrunjaya. For them, Mount Shatrunjaya is the mountain on which the Pandavas attained liberation. It was never visited by Rishabha, whose Ganadhara was known under the name of Rishabhasena. Thank you.